Hi, Anna.
Hi, Jon.
Nice to have you here. This is one of our Quartz Santal, and it's an honor for us to have you here. You are Anna Foka. Tell us about who you are.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for having me here. Organizing and planning this, I'm really grateful and honored to be part of the Quartz Santal. My name is Anna Foka, as you very correctly said, and I'm associate professor in information technology and humanities, and in digital humanities, as other people would call it more conventionally. I have a background from Liverpool University and the University of Athens, and I have a background in media and performance studies, but also in classical studies, history and archaeology of the ancient world. So I have a very antiquarian background. When I did my PhD thesis, I worked with fragmented pieces of comedy, and I tried to categorize and organize them and come up with a narrative analysis of them, and trying to understand where the ancient humor lies and what it can tell us about the ancient world today. Nowadays, I have moved into the digital realm. When I started to study in 1999, my first degree, 2000 actually I started, internet was very young. Mm-hmm. We still had these very, very old modems. But I was actually quite digital because I was fortunate to be raised in a family where all technology was passing on to the youngest children, like with clothes, you know, we were given technology. I was given technology by my brother, who's a sound engineer. And we were all huge gamers, so I had a sort of technology lying around of several platforms and several kinds. And then I remember I got some training at Durham University on digital encoding while I was finishing my PhD in 2008. And then I really got into it, and I thought this was interesting, and I'd like to work with that. So you could say I'm interested in how we look at old things in a new light, using digital technology, and how we can diversify the past with digital technology. And I brought a little...
Perfect.
Is it okay if I talk
a
little
bit? Yes, absolutely.
So this is, I don't know if you can see this very well, but this is a glass handmade Pegasus. It was given to me by my dear friend Helena. And it's actually made in Visby. But the concept of this is much, much older. Pegasus is a symbol in Greek mythology. It's a winged horse. It represents freedom of will. And it's very interesting because the archaeologists and the heritage scholars of your future, when they find this in some old and forgotten archive, they will wonder, where does it come from and what does it mean? Mm-hmm. And the story behind it is quite diverse, because this is an artifact whose narrative is actually originally Greek, but it has traveled through time to be made by a glassblower in Visby. In Visby, glassblosseria, I think it's the place where it's made. So I think that this is the way I'd like to see old things and old artifacts, and that's how I'd like to explore them with technology. How can I use technology to represent this? There are many ways one can use technology to represent
this.
Tell
us about that.
So one way is to put it in a content management system and make it searchable. Mm. So if you Google, for example, glass Pegasus, you would be able to find it. And then by enriching it with metadata in a content management system, we will be able to know its story, that it traveled from there, that it belonged to this person, its provenance, its material, its story, more altogether. We could create a 3D model of this and put it in another content management system. Mm-hmm. So perhaps my daughter, who's 6-year-old, can play with it and learn more about it in a more playful manner. Perhaps the historians and the archaeologists and the curators of the future will find it and think that how interesting it is that the story so old has traveled all the way to a Baltic island and had a new meaning, created a new meaning there. So the uses of this as a heritage object and how it connects, instead of being divided in compartmentalized in national worlds and countries, it becomes an artifact of the world that unites us.
Would you like to tell us a bit more about the disciplines that you would count as digital humanities disciplines?
I come from a very antiquarian disciplinary background where we look at the old things and we look at their reception and how we see things today or in other cultures. So I come from a very traditional humanities background, and I see digital methods and tools and the way I use them in my discipline, and I try to explore other disciplines. But I brought with me together the Routledge National Handbook of Research Methods in Digital Humanities, of which I'm part of with my research team from Umeå University. And we could talk about several different research methods in digital humanities and how these bind disciplines together. So for example, we can talk about computation and connection in digital humanities. How do we use computation to connect disparate ideas? We can talk about collaboration, so epistemology and methods by which we look at things. Mm-hmm. We can talk about geographic information systems as a way to translate narratives into data that goes into a map. So the question is limitless. I would say, how many ways are out there to infiltrate humanity through the digital lens? Well, countless, and they keep on growing, because technology is not going to go backwards. It will only go forward and move on. And with this, it will lift questions that affect humans. So there is textual analysis methods, and then there is digital cultural heritage methods, and then there is digital research infrastructures, and the list goes on and on and on.
So another question is, how do you see your research will contribute to a better world?
So digital technology gives us the possibility to open up ideas and sort of create a global footprint of them. What I'm trying to do is find the best practice to diversify collections and think about them in different ways, but also to sort of create new meaning making in artifacts that I have to do. For example, when we spoke about the Pegasus before, one of the ideas is to, there are several different ways to sort of create a digital version of it, and one is to put it in a content management system and enrich it with all these different places and people and things, and sort of create a very good description of it that will be accessible to people for future research. But also, if we could create, for example, a 3D model of this and put it up in some platform and let people interact with it in a more physical way. So I'm trying to always think back to my epistemological disciplinary training in the humanities and try to be critical and think with technology, to paraphrase Levi-Strauss.
You need to explain the term, the concept epistemology, because
epistemology. Okay, so
everyone will know.
The ways in which episteme means science in Greek.
Yeah.
So I'm sorry, I'm using all these complicated Greek words, but it's the ways in which we think of concepts, the scientific ways that we think of concepts. If that's a better way of explaining this.
Yeah.
So the way in which we think of science and things.
So it's scientific thinking.
Scientific thinking, okay. Yeah, that would be a good answer to it.
Okay. Great. Also, we were talking a bit about grants, and we just concluded that you had received a VFS grant. How do you work with this grant, and what will you do in the project? Who are the external partners in it, and what are you going to achieve?
And I think that this would be a fantastic opportunity to work together with the world, the museums of world culture, world culture museums in Sweden. These are four museums in total, and I work closer with the Museum of Mediterranean and Near Eastern Antiquities. And what we will try to do together with two colleagues and colleagues from the National Heritage Board of Sweden, Riksantikvariet Embedded in Swedish, is to find ways to create a best practice to open up the collections and create meaning making during the COVID era. As you probably know, or maybe you don't, now, right now, the museums receive about 10% of their original sort of income in Sweden because of COVID and the pandemic. There are sort of repercussions that affect their economy, but also there are, it's very difficult for people to actually visit physically the museums or use all the technology that they have. and their infrastructure. So what we will try to do is we will work between schools, the Swedish National Heritage Board and World Culture Museums to create a best practice. And in this, we work together with two colleagues that contribute their time in kind. That's Lina Eklund, who is an expert in human-computer interaction and participatory museum culture at the Information and Media Studies Department. And Nadia Tserepan, who is a visiting PhD student from Vilnius University here at Uppsala, and she's a museologist working with meaning-making in her thesis as well. So we will share responsibilities and try to create questionnaires and approach students, school students, mostly high school in Sweden, and see how we can use technology and platforms to contribute to a better sort of meaning-making of those artifacts.
Yeah. And the project will be running during the next year?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. We will begin formally in April, mm-hmm. And we're very excited to start.
Okay, yeah. Perfect. Then we are coming close to an end, I guess, for this discussion. I have a 10 million question left over here. So my question is, if you received 10 million Swedish kronor, and you could do whatever you want with that money, but it should be in research, of course, or for research purposes. How would you use the money?
Oh, I was ready to say Greta Thunberg, give it to Greta Thunberg, but then then you said research. I would love to do more in the museum sector and research better ways in which we can open up our collections to diversify the future. That's what I would like to do, and find ways to make the curators and museum professionals work easier, but also find ways to contribute back to society. For example, a very interesting thing is we have all these artifacts, let's say from Greece here in Sweden. Where do they come from, and under what circumstances did they end up here, and how? What does this mean about the globality of artifacts and the way in which we think of culture? We are basically, we're all one humanity, right? So how do we use technology to communicate that? And how can we help society? And how can we use technology for social innovation of that kind by diversifying the human memory of the past?
Are there certain sectors in society that you think should get more involved in the digital humanities?
If we could employ a lot of people to do this work and create sort of a participatory culture around this, because I mean, I have my own opinions about things, but I'm sure there's other people too. So for example, how do we connect the artifacts that come here from the Middle East to the Middle Eastern migrants of Sweden, and what do they think about it? Because that is something that actually matters, the way we think about the world. And I think we have to also create a footprint for this future of Sweden, for the face of Sweden to come. I mean, as a new Swede, and new as 2016, I became a Swedish citizen. I think there's many like me that will be the new face of Sweden, our children and our families that stay here. And we bring our own perspectives, and we are all one society now. So how do we create meaning-making for them and for us? And for everyone.
Perfect. Thanks a lot. I think that will be the final words from you and
Thank
me.
Thank you very much.
Very nice to have you here, and hope we will meet again in the future in research contexts or otherwise. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me.